always is to teach the word. So when we teach the word, what happens is, even if there is apathy among the people, they are awakened to the truth of that word. So whenever we want to see a change, a good thing to do is to teach from the word on that particular subject. Say, for example, if people don't believe in healing, if we can bring out the truth of God's word on healing and how it is available for every believer because of our covenant with God, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So faith will come and there will be a change. The same thing is applicable for apathy and self-centeredness as well. Yeah. So we could teach, right? Does that help? Sure. Yeah. Yes, Kennedy, good question there. And of course, you know, worship. So when we can engage in worship, that again, you experience the presence of God, the freshness of the work of the Spirit in our hearts. So all the hardness, right, in the presence of God, we know even mountains melt like wax. So self-centeredness and, or you know, that stiffness within us, God is able to dismantle those things as we wait on Him, as we worship Him. So maybe environment for worship, and we create an environment for worship, that will also help. Yeah, good question there, Kennedy. Anything else, class? Anything else that you're wondering about along the lines of the church being the bride? Okay. Yeah, so maybe I'll just share like one quick thing that I mean it happened to me. So there was once or twice, I don't know, and this is again, like, you know, as I'm learning to serve as a pastor, there were opportunities to preach, right? So sometimes we have these series that we follow, and then sometimes, you know, it's our own message, and we try to hear from God, what is God saying, and then based on that word, we minister to the congregation. So there were a couple of times, actually, that when I wanted to write out sermons, there were two fiery sermons that I wrote out, like, you know, the very, like, correcting and, you know, very much like, okay, everyone fall in line sort of a message. And in our pastoral team, we also kind of review, we get feedback. So when I had shared mine for feedback, I did get back, you know, this comment that, okay, why is it so, you're coming from a very sort of a strict place, okay? And is there anything going on in the congregation, you know, which requires this kind of sternness? And it really made me think, you know, about the way I am approaching God's people and the way I am expecting, yeah, this, it should be done like this, it should be done like that, you know. And so it really brought me to a place of approaching the subject at the right time and, you know, and in the right way. So, and obviously, you know, it wasn't the right time or it wasn't the right way. So I prayed through. And I kind of put away that message and I, like, rewrote another message. I wrote another sermon and then I preached that sermon. So it's happened to me a couple of times, you know, where sometimes I just want to kind of nail it and tell the people, hey, this is what you should do. This is how it should be done. And that's it. But then, you know, God works. God has been working even in my heart. And I'm kind of, I've changed the way I approach certain things and the way I deal with the church or God's people, because yes, you know, correction and all of that is important, but how do we bring it across in a loving way, or how do we lead the church in a loving way? That's very, very important. And the picture of the bride, the way God relates to his people, it really helps us also relate well with the people. So there's always that place for us to allow God to do his work of restoration, do his work of rebuilding, and do his work of healing the hearts of the people, so on and so forth. So I just thought, you know, I'd throw that thought in. If there are no questions, then we will move on, or comments, we will move on. Anything to add? Anything else to say? You can say now or forever hold your peace. Okay. Does it look like any questions are coming? So let's, yeah. I guess it's fairly simple. Okay. Let's move on. We're moving on to the next subject here, which is about the local church and the picture of the local church as a house of prayer and worship. So the body of Christ, or the believers, must be engaging in prayer. They must be engaging in intercession. They must be engaging in seeking the Lord, waiting upon the Lord, worshiping the Lord. Why is this? Because we have been called as God's people for priesthood. Okay, in the New Testament, now we see God say, 1 Peter 2:5, where we are told that we are a holy priesthood. We are a holy priesthood unto God. So that means that God expects us to offer up sacrifices to him. Okay, and in the Old Testament, he had instructed his people to set up a tabernacle. And the tabernacle also was a place where sacrifices could be offered to God and a ministry could be done unto the Lord. And even today, though we don't have the temple set up, though we don't have the the rituals that we need to follow, in a spiritual sense, we do have a ministry unto God. So ministering to people, yeah, that we are talking about it a whole lot. But you know what? Ministry to God in the form of prayer, in the form of worship, you know, and Peter also writes, you know, the giving that we do, whatever we give to God, that is also a spiritual sacrifice that we give. And our praises, the fruit of our lips, that is a sacrifice unto God. So we are here to offer up spiritual sacrifices and to minister to God. And the duty of a priest is that we have to minister to God on behalf of the people, and we have to minister to the people on behalf of God. And we, in Christ Jesus, have now become a holy priesthood. So our responsibility as believers is to constantly offer up, okay, sacrifices unto God. Now, we also know that, you know, God is a God who receives sacrifices. So if we go back to the whole ritual of sacrificing in the book of Leviticus, we see that God had instructed people to sacrifice, and the first fire was sent from heaven to consume the sacrifice. And that is the fire, you know, which God had instructed the people to keep burning and to never put it off. Okay, so when does God send the fire? God provides the fire when we present the sacrifice. So no sacrifice, no fire. And we know fire is representing of God's presence. It represents God's anointing. So how can we have more of God's presence? How can we have more of God's anointing? When there is a sacrifice, we give the sacrifice, he sends the fire. So for us to have the fire, we have to offer up the sacrifice to God. And our sacrifice to God, you know, we talked about different things, but we must keep it constant, and we must keep it we must keep giving it unto the Lord. Now, when we look at the presence of God, you know, we've talked about this, that our prayers, when we studied about prayer and intercession, we said that our prayers go as incense in the heavens before God. And, you know, that's something that is ministering in the presence of God. Now, even when we look at the structure and the makeup of the tabernacle, God had instructed for an incense to be provided, right? This was in the inner chamber. There was always an incense burning in the presence of the Lord. And, you know, for God to accept that, God had also spoken to Moses about how to prepare this fragrance, the fact that it must be pure. Okay, it must be prepared only for the purposes of the tabernacle, that it must not be used in any other way, and that, you know, it should not be used for anyone else. Okay, so that also shows that we come before the Lord with devotion and commitment, and we present our sacrifices unto the Lord. And yes, as the sacrifice would go up, or the incense would keep burning in the presence of God, we know that the presence of God would take over the Holy of Holies, and, you know, God's presence would be there in that compound. So today, for us, right, as we become that royal priesthood and offer up our sacrifices unto the Lord, and especially incense is equated with a prayer, it's equated with worship. As we offer that up unto the Lord, you know, we must remember this. As God instituted for the incense to be prepared in a special way, only for Him, our worship is also only for our God. We don't worship other things in our lives, or we don't worship people in our lives, but our worship is dedicated only to our God. And the worship which we offer to God, the way the tabernacle had a method of preparation, and it had to be holy and pure. Even our worship, you know, God is seeking holy and pure worship from us. You know, not something that is mixed with our selfishness or our pride or the works of the flesh, but it is holy and pure worship unto the Lord. So as God's people, the point we are making is we are called to minister to God. We are called to minister to God with our worship, with our prayer. Now, a beautiful picture of ministering to God is seen in the tabernacle of David. And we have touched on this when we studied about prayer and intercession, but I'll quickly go over it once again. So the tabernacle of David, for those of us who are not familiar, David brought a worship to God which impressed him. Okay, this is about 1000 BC. David, as an outflow of his heart, he wanted to establish a tent for worship. And nobody had ever done this before, but he commanded that the Ark of the Covenant be brought and, you know, it be placed in a tent, and that, you know, there be people who were dedicated to worship in that tent. So we can read more about this in 1 Chronicles chapter 15. He appointed people within the tent to lead in the worship. So the numbers look something like, you know, he appointed 4,000 musicians, 4,000 gatekeepers, 288 prophetic singers who ministered to the Lord. How often? We are told day and night. Okay, and that is what David really wanted to do. He wanted to worship God, offer up the sacrifice of praise unto the Lord non-stop. So day and night. And that is why he needed so many people to come and bring worship to God. So these people were appointed to come before the Lord day and night, to make petition, to give thanks, and to praise the Lord. And this went on and on and on. And we see that the duration of this 24/7 constant praise, worship, prayer lasted for 33 years. And what is so special about this kind of worship? You know, the fact is that God was very impressed with it. Okay, and we will see later on that you know, He chooses to have this kind of worship back in the church. So first, let's touch upon some of the features of David's tent of worship, or we are calling it the tabernacle of worship. So what are some of the features? There was extravagant worship and powerful intercession, you know, which was offered up to God through the tabernacle. And it's very plain to see, you know, who would appoint so many musicians and you know, vocalists, worshipers. So David had to select from the best in his kingdom, and he appointed them. As we study the tabernacle, we understand that he even paid them and told them, this is what I want you to dedicate yourself to. Why did David do that? He wanted the best worship for God. Okay, and he gave God extravagant worship. And during that time, we also understand that powerful intercession was made, and that is the feature of the tabernacle of worship. So today for us, if we want to emulate David's tabernacle of worship, then we're talking about extravagant worship. We're talking about, you know, powerful intercession. It was also a place of prophetic worship. In 1 Chronicles 25, we see that there were people chosen to lead in singing. There were people chosen to write songs. Write songs because it was prophetic worship. They needed to hear from God and they needed to sing those songs in the now. So people were kind of trained under leaders to do this. And you know, there were several people who were appointed. So there were people appointed for leading in singing, using instruments, writing songs, releasing those songs, so on and so forth. And we see that these songs, right, these songs were not just sung because they needed to be sung, but we see the term skillful, okay, used in these passages. So David was careful to identify people who could provide excellent worship and excellent prophetic worship at that. And we are told that several psalms, which, you know, we read today, were birthed out of this move of the tabernacle of David's worship. What else? What are some of the other features we see? So there was extravagant worship, there was prophetic worship. So what does prophetic worship mean? See, it simply means that it's more than coming to God and saying, okay, God, we have two praise songs and we have three worship songs. So, you know, two fast songs, three slow songs, and, you know, that's the worship we are offering you. But prophetic worship is to hear from God. You know? As the leaders hear from God, maybe God is releasing a line or two. And this morning in the prayer, it was Elisha. I don't know if Elisha is here in second year class, but Elisha, somebody. Yeah, they wrote out some lines that God gave them. So that's prophetic, right? And the words are being released. And I'm just reminded of when we have a physical Bible college that happens here in Bangalore, we also have every day from 12 to 1, we have a time called Supernatural Hour, where after the classes are done, all the students and, you know, faculty who can stay back, we all gather, and then we have a time of worship. We have a time of intercession. So we just get deep into it every day. Okay, every day it happens. And we just kind of, you know, worship God and we hear from God and we minister as the Lord is leading us to minister. And I can recall this one particular batch. I don't remember the year, but that year, students were writing songs every session. At the end of the session, they'd be like, oh man, I got three lines. I got, you know, somebody else got a few lines. And one of our students, she started a blog site on which she puts, even till today, the songs, she gets the songs, the words, and she puts it up on that page, the words that God is giving to her prophetically. One of our students from, I think she was from Punjab, And she would write in Hindi. She would write in Hindi, and she would get words. I don't remember the exact count, but when she was graduating, she told me something like, I've written 24 songs, okay, just through the supernatural hours of worship. So, I mean, I don't want to get deep into it, but I felt like I must talk about it now. So prophetic worship, we're talking about the now, what is God releasing? Those words, we worship him with those words, we worship him with that revelation. So that's prophetic worship, and David kind of instituted that, right, in the tabernacle of worship. So what are the other features? We find orderly worship with excellence. So we said he chose the best of the best in terms of skill, and as we read these passages, we understand that there were groups of people. So there were 24 groups or teams of musicians and singers. So they had a pattern and a schedule to follow. They were not randomly assigned to lead, but you know, they followed a systematic way to lead worship in the tabernacle. So there was an order which they followed, you know, and there were skilled musicians who would train others in music, and then you would have that same excellence maintained among the singers. So David's tabernacle had all these features, and no wonder, you know, there's excellence, there's order, there's extravagant worship, where David didn't hold anything back. And you know, we see that in David's life. He says, how can I give God the second best? You know, how can I give God leftovers? So he always tried to give his best to God, and God was very, very pleased with it. Now, God was so pleased with this manner of worship. And you know, David's worship was extravagant, but any and every ruler that came after David that engaged in worship, God was always pleased with all of them. And whoever kind of reinstituted this method of worshiping God during that tenure, we find that great blessings came upon that ruler and the people of the land. So some of the names would be Solomon. He tried reinstituting worship in the temple, and you know, he was blessed. Jehoshaphat was another person. Joash, Hezekiah, Josiah, Ezra, Nehemiah. So all of these people engaged in this form of worship, and they were blessed during their times. So what do we gain from this? Basically, we gain that whenever we create a place of worship, it becomes the habitation of God. Okay, and when God's presence comes and God begins to dwell there, we talked about these rulers and their land being blessed. How is it that their land was blessed? How is it that they experienced, you know, a certain level of transformation because of, you know, the sacrifice? They provided the sacrifice, God provided the fire, and God's presence comes in, and God's presence begins to work in the midst of the people, begins to work among the, you know, on across the land. And, you know, we see that God is able to do an incredible work. So God loved this kind of dedication that David had, okay, his heart for worship, that the prophet Amos, he prophesies, and he says in Amos chapter 9, verses 11 to 13, I think it'll be good for somebody to read this passage. It is in our notes on page number 90. Amos 9, verses 11 through 13. Somebody?
Shall I read, ma'am?
Yes, Amy, please go ahead.
Okay. Amos 9, 11 to 13 says, on that day, I will raise up the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down, and repair its damages. I will raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of the old, that they may possess the remnant of Edom and all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord who does this thing. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when the plowman shall overtake the reaper and the treader of grapes him who sows seed. The mountains shall drip with sweet wine, and all the hills shall flow with it.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you, Amin. Thank you for reading that. So the prophet Amos, what he's saying is, he says, on that day, which is this day? You know, a day which is to come. On that day, God is promising, I will, meaning definitely, I am going to do this, raise up the tabernacle of David. Tabernacle of David existed 33 years and gone. But the reinstitution happened through other rulers. Now God is saying, I'm going to, that's why you would have heard this term. You know, some worship events, they use the term rebuilding. Rebuilding the tabernacle of David. So God is saying, I will raise up, I will rebuild the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down, and repair its damages. I will raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of old. So God is talking about re-establishing a place of continuous prayer, praise, worship, and thanksgiving. So as a result of that, what can we see happen? So once God builds this, rebuilds this tabernacle of David, he says, verse 12, that they may possess the remnant of Edom. And all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord, who does this thing. So Edom refers to those who are not in God, okay, those who are away from God. And similarly, even the Gentiles, right? Gentiles who are not God's people. They are, I'm sorry, I can hear somebody is on unmute. So I just want to request it. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so Edom refers to those who are not in Christ, or you know, those who are yet to be brought into the kingdom of God. And Gentiles as well. So what God is saying is, when we re-establish this form of worship, as a result, there is going to be a winning of souls. Okay, we can use the term harvest, a harvest of souls into the kingdom of God. Verse 13, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when the plowman shall overtake the reaper and the treader of grapes him who sows seed. The mountain shall drip with sweet wine, and all the hills shall flow with it. So what God is saying is, he's saying there is going to be a great harvest, a plentiful harvest, such that the reapers will be very busy gathering the harvest from the previous season. There'll be so much harvest that when the sowing season comes, you know, by then the harvesting should have been over, but the harvesting is still going on. There is a plentiful harvest. So we can look forward for the Great Commission to be fulfilled in such a mighty way. But what is a prerequisite of people coming into the kingdom of God? The rebuilding of the tabernacle of David. So God has promised this and said that there is going to be a day when I will rebuild it. Now, if we just fast forward a little bit, in Acts chapter 15, we find the then pastor of the church, or the then leader of the church, James, the brother of Jesus, stand up and quote from Amos. Okay? This is in Acts chapter 15, verses 16 through 17. He says the same, you know, he kind of says the same thing that Amos said about rebuilding the tabernacle of David and the bringing in of the Gentiles into the family of God. So why is James talking about it? See, by then, in the early church, the gospel had, God had opened doors for the gospel to be preached to the Gentiles. Okay, and there needed to be an acceptance among the Jews of another community coming into the kingdom of God. So he was reminding the people and telling them, don't you remember? God has already spoken through the prophet, and he told us that there are Gentiles who are called by his name who will also come into the kingdom of God. So he's kind of reminding the people that this is the time when it has to happen. So where is the rebuilding of the temple, a rebuilding of the tabernacle of David going to happen? It's going to happen in and through the church, because we are those spiritual representatives of the kingdom of God. Yeah, and that's what we've been talking about. So as the church rebuilds, again, in a spiritual sense, we may not set up a building or a tent, but what we will do is engage, you know, in this form of worship, abandoned worship, extravagant. The term used is extravagant worship. When we engage in that kind of worship, what happens? You know, God's presence comes. We provide the sacrifice, He provides the fire, and then everything that goes with it, particularly the promise of Amos, where we see that many people are going to come into the house of God. So there's going to be a transformation, right? And that's what God is looking for. Now, we've understood the importance of worship, the importance of prayer, the importance of intercession. Now, God wants His house or the church to be a house of prayer and that of worship. So this text is actually in Isaiah 56 verses 6 through 7. Again, I would request someone to please read the passage. I'm on page 91. Isaiah 56 verses 6 through 7.
I read.
Yeah,
Isaiah 56 verse 6 to 7. Also the sons of the fallen who joined themselves to the Lord, to serve Him and to love the name of the Lord, to be His servants, everyone who keeps from defiling the Sabbath and holds fast My covenant, even them I will bring to My holy mountain and make them joyful in My house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on My altar, for My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Charles. So, you know, we see God's desire put before us very clearly. God wants us to be a house of praise, worship, that we've seen. Now, God is clearly telling us that His house or the church, okay, has to be a house of prayer. And God is zealous for that. And we see Jesus quote the same passage when He chases out money lenders from the temple. So in Matthew 21, where people are doing business, okay, in the temple, Jesus goes there and He makes a whip, He overturns the tables, and you know, He quotes this. He says, "My house shall be called a house of prayer." So He was consumed by zeal, because the temple, which is supposed to be a place of prayer and worship, it had been turned into a place of merchandise and business. Okay. So how does this apply to the church today? We have to be careful not to let other things slowly creep into the church. And we know that, you know, Satan never tries to enter directly, or he never tries to enter with a big noise. Very subtly, he would love to come in to somehow turn our hearts from worship, from seeking Him in prayer, you know, to other things. And we slowly give our attention to, you know, the things of the world. But Jesus never liked that. He always wanted His temple to be known as a house of prayer. And we have to also be zealous to maintain that. Those of us, we're serving the church, we're serving in various capacities. Never let this focus be shifted in any way. Okay? This is our house. It must be a house of prayer. It must be a house of worship. And, you know, we don't want other things to come and dilute what God has called us to do. So, yeah, we direct people in this manner and we lead them to engage in prayer and worship. Okay. So how does our prayer, that is the next section here, which talks about our prayer going up into the very presence of God. It goes up as incense. Earlier, we see shadows on the earth. Okay? God tells us, okay, you do this, you burn incense in the tabernacle. But also, we see that there is something else, you know, which is more real than the shadow. So Psalm 141 verse 2, it says, you know, let my prayer be set before you as incense, the lifting up of my hands as an evening sacrifice. And then in the book of Revelation, I think it's Revelation 8, if I'm not wrong, I was just looking, yeah, Revelation 8, we see that right before God, the incense goes up. Okay, and that incense is the prayer of the saints. So what is that real incense? It is the prayer of the saints, and it goes directly into the presence of God. So when we pray from the earth and when we engage in worship, you know, it's directly ministering in God's presence. It's directly touching God. And you know, that is an encouragement for us, right? That is an encouragement for us. And we know that in the presence of God, you know, there's worship going on the whole time, the entire time, the worship that we offer to God, you know, when we say that God is worthy, but also you have our heavenly beings resounding with the worship unto God, where they're also crying out to God, and you know, they're also saying, you know, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. So basically, they also realize that, you know, it's only God who is worthy of our worship. So worship is going up in heaven all the time. Prayer is going up, and we become a part of that. We kind of come in sync with what is happening in heaven. Okay, it is happening right now. It will continue to happen throughout eternity. And we are aligning ourselves to that heartbeat of heaven when we are engaging in prayer, when we are engaging in worship. So just I'm going to touch on that worship that the heavenly beings give unto the Lord. This is in Revelation 5:12, where the Lamb of God, okay, is deemed as worthy to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. So what does it mean? We'll quickly look at that. So it means that it is only our God who has power, and power has to do with influence, authority, dominion, sovereignty. So we're saying, you know, God, you have the greatest influence. You are sovereign over everything. Our God has all the riches, because, you know, we're saying riches is due unto the Lord. So what do riches contain? Wealth, possessions, so everything. Right? Everything belongs to him. Wisdom has to do with knowledge, with understanding, with skill. So where can we get it from? Only he has it. So we say that, okay, God, you have it all. You have all wisdom. You have all strength. Strength has to do with might. It has to do with ability. And that is in God. And you know, God can offer that to us. Then all honor is due unto the Lord. Honor has to do with respect, reverence, our submission unto the King. Glory. Glory has to do with God's might, God's splendor. So, you know, we give him all the glory. And blessing is our adoration, okay, our admiration and our love. So even that belongs to God. And that's the kind of worship that goes on in heaven. And, you know, we join along with that worship, and we praise and thank God. So what I'll do is I will pause right now. We still have to touch on a section on the movements of prayer. So I won't rush through it. We will look at it maybe in the next class. But any thoughts, any questions as of now? We've been talking about the Tabernacle of David. We've been talking about the church being the house of prayer. Okay, so yeah, anything along those lines?
Thank you, Pastor. I enjoyed this class. It's just kind of coincidental that this class actually clashes, no, connects with my study, because I'm actually studying when I started studying from yesterday, when David brought the Ark of the Covenant, you know, back, and then how we apportioned the singers, you know. So as you were just actually talking about it, it was just throwing more light that, wow, interesting. Actually, when I was reading it, I didn't really even think of it so much. Though I was meditating on it, I didn't think about it, about him actually, because this was something he started, you know. He started, he was the one that instituted the whole worship of singing day and night. I mean, in the time of Moses, this was not done. So this was David actually starting something new, you know. And it just goes to show that really, God actually, you know, enjoys when we worship him in songs of praises, you know, when we offer him songs of thanksgiving. And no wonder David, till to this day, is being reckoned with as one of the greatest kings. You know, we had so many kings in the land of Israel, but David still remains like the one most, like, even the sign on the flag of Israel, you know, it's actually the sign of David. So it tells us the importance and how much God treasures when we actually offer him praises, we offer him worship, you know, in thanksgiving and praise. So I think that has really, really, like, buttressed the importance why we must never cease to give him sacrifices of praise, worship him in praise and thanksgiving. I think this is a very, very good class that has stressed on that. And as we pray, we should not also forget, you know, to also to worship in praise and thanksgiving. In fact, I believe prayer is an orchestra of everything, you know, worshiping at the same time praying. You know, most times when we always go to pray, we are always just about our needs, our interests, but I think God wants us to go beyond not just praying for what we want in our lives, but basically praying his will and then worshiping him from a standpoint that he's inspiring us, he's showing us himself, and he wants us to, you know, offer him what will please him, you know, what will bring him pleasure. And David showed that, and I think we should even do more than what was done in the old covenant, because these guys were praying before an ark, but we are the temple of the Lord. We are his tabernacle. We carry him. So a lot is expected from us if these men who never even had the Spirit of God within them could do this, then I think a lot also should come from us. God is expecting more from us. So thank you, Pastor, for this class. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sai. Blessed to hear, you know, your thoughts and some of the understanding that you have developed. So how about you pray today to wrap up the class, and if you could also pray that we as God's people, like, we will rebuild that tabernacle of worship individually and in our churches and as the body of Christ. Yeah, would you be able to pray for us also, Sai? As you wrap
no
up,
problem.
Yeah.
No worries.
Go ahead. Thank
you. Let us pray. Our dear Father, we bless you. Thank you for your word. We have heard today the teachings, Lord, that we've been exposed to and has been revealed to us by your word and by your servant. Lord, we thank you, Jesus, Lord, for making us your tabernacle, for dwelling within us. Father, as we've learned today, that indeed it is this time, O God, that you are rebuilding the tabernacle, and that is us. We pray that, Father, individually and as at churches everywhere, you know, wherever we are, Lord, in our various churches and the body of Christ at large, I pray, Father, that, Lord, you would take us back to that which pleases you, that which brings you pleasure. And that is, Lord, offering worship unto you, you know, praying unto you, praying your will here on earth, that your kingdom may come and be fully expressed, Lord, here on earth. We pray that, Lord, we will give ourselves, Lord, to worship in thanksgiving and praise, and that we'll never cease praying. We pray, Father, that the fire you have put inside of us, that, Lord, will always be a living sacrifice for the fire to keep on burning. We pray that, Lord, we would not be missing, Lord, when you expect us, Lord, to stand in the gap, interceding, praying, Lord, that your kingdom, Lord, will find expression and be enthroned in the hearts of men. We pray that, Lord, continually our lips will be filled with thanksgiving, will be filled with thanksgiving and praise continually. Father, we pray that, Lord, your presence, Lord, will be in our churches, that your presence, O Lord, will be invited in the midst of our worship, in the midst of our praises. We pray that, Lord, we would look to you always. And we pray that, Lord, we'll be truly representatives of you. And that, Lord, we would carry ourselves as your temple. That, Lord, we will know, we'll have this consciousness that, Lord, we carry you on the inside and we'll be representatives of you everywhere we go. Thank you, Father, Lord, for your daughter you've used, all to teach us. Lord, replenish her. Lord, inspire her more. And Lord, anoint her more, Lord, for greater works. Thank you, Father, as we go, Lord, for our other class. Lord, pray for understanding and we pray for more wisdom in the name of Jesus. Thank you, for in Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you. Thank you so much, Say. Thank you. And God bless you all. Thank you for being here. Yeah, take care. And yeah, God bless you. Feel free to thank your business. Yeah, thank you.
Pastor.
Bye. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you,
Pastor. Thank you. Thank you. Bye. God bless everyone.